extraordinary. I haven't had a cough all day. I've been feeling so much better. No sore throat, no nothing. Just before starting this video, suddenly this in my throat, suddenly this coughing was, you know, forcing its way. This that's so extraordinary. And it came about when I had a thought, and the thought was, I'm incapable of seeing anyone needing this world. I'm incapable of seeing anyone as needing this world. As soon as I had that thought, wham, in my throat, and I began to pulse, coughing. Good Lord. Wasn't a hint of it before. It was immediate. My breathing became compromised. So I'm incapable. I find myself now incapable of seeing anyone needing any world at all. This is just an affirmation. I am incapable of seeing anyone as needing any world whatsoever. It's like there's something immediately tries to interfere with my ability to speak. So say this, try to say this. I now find myself incapable of seeing anyone that needs a world. Anyone that needs a world. No, I'm incapable of seeing anyone needing a world. Or, also, I'm incapable of anyone seeing anyone needing a body. I don't see anyone as needing a body. I don't see anyone as needing a world. Incapable of seeing it that way. So since this is where we have to get to, we might as well affirm that we're there. Because it's the affirming that we're there that is the getting there. Because all we're doing is we're affirming we're not there. And then throwing a frame around that picture to make it seem, you know, like we must keep that picture because we have to keep the frame. No, we don't have to keep either. All there is to delusion is just our denial of truth. Denial that we're not already here. So the only remedy is to drop that and just affirm that we are here. All this work we're doing is just putting a frame around the denial to take our attention off the fact that it's merely just a denial and saying, oh, I'm not here. So we say, I find myself incapable of seeing anyone needing a body or a world. In the saying of that, that's that I'm here, that is what I see then. And not seeing it is merely worshiping time, trying to buy time. Say, well, I can't see it yet. all there is to denial of reality is this belief in time that, well, I don't see it yet. I don't see reality. I can't see it yet. But it's still there, isn't it? It's just a delaying tactic. So we might as well just try it, saying, hey, I'm already incapable of seeing anyone needing a body or a world. I'm incapable of seeing any need for a body or a world in anyone. And just accept this. Now the world will say that you're incapable, you're experiencing incapacity. And they say, we got to cure you of that incapacity. They say, no thanks. It's like saying that I'm incapable of getting sick. Why would I want to be cured of that incapacity? What kind of cure is that? Oh, I'm sick now. Oh, great. I no longer have the incapacity of getting sick. This is what the world taught me when I came here. Hey, we've got some really great capabilities to remove some of these incapacities that you have. Yeah, we're going to teach you how to be sick and age and die and be sad and miserable and fearful and isolated and alone. And it's like we're going to remove all those blocks to misery that you have, all these incapacities. We're going to expand your capacities by removing these incapacities. Huh? Yeah. I'm incapable of being trapped. And they say, oh wow, let's fix that incapacity. Let's make sure you're trapped. Expanding your capabilities. Now, not only can you be what you are, but you can also be what you're not. See, before I said, well, I'm incapable of being anything other than what I am. And they said, no, we can make you capable of being what you aren't. And now you're much freer, you're much greater. You see, you have greater capabilities now. And they say, we can even make you not incapable of not existing. I say, well, if I don't exist, how am I greater than existing? How is that greater than existing? Well, it's both. You both exist and you also don't exist. How can I both exist and not exist? Well, those are the capabilities that you can develop. Really? Maybe it sounds more like a split mind. Well, that you can develop that capability too, actually. In fact, you can develop all sorts of mental illness. Capabilities to be mentally ill. It's like, wow, this place is really amazing. How it expands my capabilities so much. So dumb that I think this is all wonderful. So let's just say, wow, to sit here for a while. Wow, this is amazing what we're seeing here. We're seeing the Hansel and Gretel and the witch with the gingerbread house. Like, hey, I'm going to show you how capable you are climbing into that oven. Well, God doesn't want us to. Well, I'm going to show you. That you're capable of doing what God doesn't want you to do. Hey, you see, isn't that amazing? Capabilities? Oh, really? So let's just look at this in good humor. So we can respond. There's nothing that God tells me I cannot do. Nothing that I'm completely free. So how can you expand my capabilities? I'm free to choose whatever I want. There's never a question of expanding my capabilities. If I want to believe I can be sick, that capability is already there. I'll choose not to. I want to believe that I'm not free. I'm capable of believing that. But I'm still free. Free to believe something else. So how can my capabilities be expanded? So you see, now we're starting to get onto the situation. The trick is that they only say you need. I don't need to expand my capabilities. In fact, I cannot, because they're already perfectly infinite. But that feeling of freedom is always there. So as we sit quietly like this, we're able to get into this very interesting looking and seeing and clarifying here that we would not ordinarily do watching the television. You know? this requires a full stop in the wow. So when the trickster says, hey, I know how to expand your capabilities. God has some secrets, didn't give you all power and all freedom that can expand your capability. Really? Is that true? Is that a lie? What they're really saying is, I can expand your capability by showing you that you're not capable. But how does that expand our capability? By believing that we're not capable of being well, for instance. Not capable of being eternal life. We're not capable. How does seeing all this stuff that we supposedly are not capable of, how does that expand our capabilities? calls that an improvement, improving upon God. Something doesn't smell right here. Can our freedom be sick? No. Well, then what is sick? What they're really saying is you're capable of not being free, meaning you're capable of losing capacity. That's what they're saying. Hey, you're capable of, you're so capable, you're capable, even capable of losing capacity. Well, guess what? God says no to that. That's not true. So at some point we have to recite God and say, well, God tells us that this is not so, that I cannot lose capacity. So I'll only be engaging in a futile sort of effort. And they say, well, then how about, oh really? They say, okay, well then you got to then limit this non-capacity. You gotta learn to limit this. No, there is no non-capacity. So why do I need to learn to limit what doesn't exist? And the wicked witch, the sorceress, is now starting to get nervous, you know. See? Deal isn't looking so good. God says I cannot lose capacity, so it's futile to attempt it. So I'll just be engaging in futility. Well, you can learn to limit the futility. Really? Learn to limit futility? Futility? What is that? Isn't that just more futility? Isn't that just doubling down on futility? Learning to limit futility? If something's futile, it's futile. How can you limit it? Limit that futility? And then the witch says, I will rescind the offer to help you limit your futility. If you don't accept this right now. So we just remain quiet, really. We could say, well, I'm not experiencing any futility because I'm not trying to limit my capability in any way. I realize that I cannot limit my capability. So I'm experiencing complete capability. How is that futility? How is failing to be to be futile? How is that futile? So, defining the incapacity we have of incapacitating ourselves is futility, and then claiming that we're going to be helped to cure this terrible futility you have, this awful futility of being unable to limit yourself. It's horrible. We're here to cure that. Well, who needs a cure for that? What we do here is we make sure there's plenty of open space, open light, quietness. But we don't want to throw just a wall of rhetoric at you, at ourselves. For instance, the difference between like A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. A Course in Miracles was perfect for its time, because back then it was like a block of writing is this, you know, was like what we felt was what we needed. So I loved it. My gosh, just page after page after page, just wall of text, wall of text, wall of text. And ultimately, I found that I no longer like that. After 15 years. And then I found Journey Beyond Words, where it's put in like poetry style. A partial line comma goes to another line comma. It's prose in poetry format. Space on the page and breaks, and it's like, wow, I love this. So I just went back tonight and started reading A Course in Miracles, and I said, I can't take this wall of text, I cannot take it. And I went back to Journey Beyond Words, like, oh my gosh, it's so much better. But in its time, when we were at the height of academic fixation, that was required, of course, that style was required. I mean, you got to feel sophisticated and smart and capable. And here was the proof that you were. Look at this, you could tackle this 600-page wall of text, you know, wow. I was part of it, so. But now I just, no, I can't take it anymore. So here, we're not just going to lay out a wall of text. Because ultimately it's a journey beyond words. So we're just looking here at this little trickery of, hey, we're here, we have a secret, we can remove this incapacity that you have for incapacity. You have an incapacity for incapacity. So we're going to help you remove that incapacity. But a double negative like that's a positive, isn't it? Why we want to remove a positive? Say that this is driven by what, sour grapes, someone who gets pulled down by this trick, they can't stand the fact that others are free in full capacity, and they're struggling with this futility, thinking that they're better, but they're not, and they want to pull others down. Misery loves company. They say, I just can't stand the freedom that they have. I gotta make them not free. So let's try this little trick. They say, well, you're not free to not be free. Well, that's right. That means I'm free. They said, no, you're not free because you can't be not free. That's a double negative. That means that's great. I am free. But you don't understand, they say. I say, well, there's nothing to understand. Double negative, there isn't any negative to understand. But you just don't understand. There's nothing to understand. Complaining about the Wicked Witch isn't going to resolve the problem. Will it? We have to. How do we? Well, let's just sit quietly and look at it. Why do we want to do this and except be greater than God? Say, God, I have even a greater capacity than you. I can even be incapacitated. God says, actually, you cannot. You can dream of incapacitation, but you're free, still free at any moment to not dream of incapacitation. So you're not incapacitated. Okay. So when we're dreaming a dream, and we see all these processes, and we see a pot of gold, there's railway station, and you see people going towards it, and they say, I gotta get to it. And we say, I gotta keep dreaming because the only way I can be happy, I gotta find this goal. And so we feel incapable of waking up, because if we wake up, we won't be happy or something. So in a dream, when we reference the dream figures and what they're doing, from that standpoint, it doesn't seem like they are capable of not being in the dream, right? They seem to be in the grip of the dream. So when God says, you're perfectly capable at any moment to not be dreaming this dream of incapacity. When we look at the dream figures, they don't seem capable of stopping the dream. They seem to be somehow inexorably drawn into all this activity in the dream. Like they don't have any capacity to stop the dream at all. And so we say, well, I don't, God, what are you talking about, dude? I can't stop the dream. I'm busy living here in the world. And God says, no, that those are just the dream figures that you're dreaming. I didn't say the dream figures can stop the dream, because they're not dreaming the dream. So how can they stop the dream? Only the dreamer can stop the dream. So God says, you're not incapacitated just because you're dreaming a dream of incapacitation, because at any moment you're perfectly free to drop that dream of incapacitation. So how is that, how are you incapacitated? The only way we can believe we're incapacitated is by referencing the dream figures and claiming that they are us. They are what we are. That's our identity. And then we can claim we're greater than God, because we say, God, I'm not able to stop this dream of incapacitation, actually, God. So that's the only way we can claim it. Say, God, the dream has incapacitated me. I can't choose. And says, no, God says, no, it's not true. You're just choosing to keep dreaming, that's all. But in no way in looking at the dream can we know, realize that we're capable of stopping, ending the dream this instant. Right? We look at this world. What evidence do we have that this world, that all this can vanish in an instant? What evidence? Absolutely none. See? So we have to, you know, trust God, because we're so used to trying to pull the wool over God's eyes and say, God, what are you talking about? I don't see how this world can stop. Again, in a dream world, we're dreaming of a world. When we're having a dream of a world, does it ever occur to us in the dream that, you know what, all this could just like vanish instantly? I have the power to make all the circumstances vanish instantly. Does that ever occur to when we're having a dream, to the dream figures? Do they say, hey, you know, I can make all this vanish instantly. Just a dream. Well, if it should, awareness should be like that in what you're dreaming, that means you're waking up, you're realizing, hey, I'm spirit, I'm free. I'm not a body, I'm spirit, I'm free, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, I have had several, maybe three times in dreams where I was looking at situation in a dream and I just said, hey, wait a minute. I could change the situation right away. It doesn't have to be like this at all. I remember I literally made the whole ocean and land and coastline pivot and move just like that in the dream. I had several situations where I was able to completely circumvent all laws of the dream, as it were, and do things which are clearly didn't come about through any of the processes within the dream at all. And so these are little signs of awakening, actually. Recently, where some terrible pirates were trying to catch at least this figure that I was sort of watching what's going on. I was like a protector sort of the situation, and wow, I said, this is looking bad for them. Well, why don't I just hit the channel, change the channel, there's no more pirates. Then you say, well, we never find out if that person actually escaped the pirates. So what do you mean there're no pirates anymore? So how can there be an issue of escaping them? Say, hey pirates, it's too late. I realize this is just a dream. It's just a dream. I realized it was just only a dream. Too late. And being that it's just a dream, poof, it just vanished. Do the pirates know they just vanished? It doesn't matter. You can always bring them back. So back to the root of this. God says, hey, you're not incapacitated. And we say, oh sure. All this world is all these, everything has to keep going on. It's not free at all. God says, what do you mean? You can stop dreaming this dream this instant. You're not incapacitated to choose do something else. And then they say, well, God, before I do that, can I at least see a nice dream? I hate to have this all vanish and it be all so terrible. Says, sure, why not? You can choose a nice dream. Where nobody's threatened, nothing is threatened. You see, we keep watching this dream and say, who's going to be incapacitated? There's all this incapacitation taking place. Wow, it's an amazing dream. Gotta learn to limit this incapacitation. Why not see a dream where there's no incapacitation taking place at all. Just let this filter. Don't have an answer for it. Don't try to answer it. Just say, wow. Interesting. Speculation here. Just let it just be like that. If we don't see any incapacitation, we say, God, I don't know. I don't have the opportunity to overcome the incapacitation. I'm trying to overcome this incapacitation. And God says, there isn't any. You can't overcome what doesn't exist. incapacitation. By having this dream of incapacity, I cannot change it. I cannot let drop the dream. It was a dream of incapacity. I've got to cure that. God says, no, you were never incapacitated. You're always free. You could, any instant, you could choose not to dream this dream. So do we need to make the figures in the dream free? Do we need to know how they got free? Is that really necessary? How they got free? How about just seeing them as free right now? If we were never incapacitated at all, why do we need to see how dream figures got free? Were they ever incapacitated, actually? No, because you could have changed the dreaming at any instant. So there was never any incapacitation in the dream, actually. So why is there even an issue of how do we get these dream figures free of incapacitation? They were never incapacitated in the first place. But we don't need to keep pretending that there is this incapacity. We just stop pretending there's something that doesn't exist. That's why we can say, I'm already there. There's no how to it. There's no how to it. How did I get dream figures to stop being so incapacitated? They never were. So how can there be a how to it? When we try to bring a how to it, we're claiming that they were incapacitated at some point and we somehow got them out of it. No, they never were. How can a dream figure be incapacitated? It's like we have a dream figure and we want them chopped up. And then we decide, oh, no. I decide I don't want them chopped up. Oh, and then they're no longer chopped up. You know, I want them this way. Oh, no, I don't want them to be this way. I want this dream figure to be crippled and deformed and crippled. And you say, yeah, you know what? I changed my mind. I don't want to be crippled. Oh, they're perfectly well. So were they ever really incapacitated? Is anyone really incapacitated? Not really. Is there any incapacitation actually at all? And the answer is no. But we say, God, I don't want to stop seeing dream figures all together, you know, this is scary. How about if I just, can I just see them in a state where incapacity, you know, where there isn't any dream incapacity, something like that. We keep trying to free ourselves. That's ridiculous. We're already free. The effort to free ourselves is what keeps us feeling we're not free. Because who is already free tries to free themselves? Except one who is trying to prove that they're not free. So we're just loosening up the fabric here. Not trying to cling to any results, just loosening it up, getting comfortable. comfortable here. So maybe, you know, one of the first steps would be your dreams. As you're dreaming, you really start, have power over your dreams, start just changing them. So wait a minute, be consciously, wait a minute, I don't have to be dreaming this. I can change it to this. You don't have to find out what happens in a dream at all. Which means we really don't need to dream at all, right? Ultimately, those who are awakened, they may seem to go to sleep, but they don't dream at all. They don't enter that dream state at all. Even enter the dream state that we call the daytime state, but we claim as a non-dreaming, whereas it's still, that too is a dream. But the basics of saying, we're saying, God, we're not free. We're not capable. We have this capability of not being free now. And God says, no, you don't. We say, sure we do. Look at this dream. I have this dream. I'm not capable of ending this dream. It just, God says, sure you can. But there's all these figures who are incapable. All these incapacities. I've got to heal them first. I can't. No, you don't. You're free. Every instant you're free still. Even though you're having a dream of incapability, you're capable of dropping that dream of incapability. Any instant. So how are you incapable? You have not proven that you're incapable at all. And so we need to start seeing evidence that we haven't proven it at all. In fact, it's futile. We can't prove that we're incapable. It's not possible. It's just a waste. But if we take the dream as our central point of reference, then it seems like we are proving it. We just need to be patient with this. It gets a little tricky. Or at least it can seem that way to us. We say our dream figures. We want our dream figures to be incapable of us changing them. That they have to work it out, follow certain laws and dynamics and everything, and we can't do anything about it. So when our dream figure's in trouble, we say, "Well, I can't do anything about it." You know, you have this incapacity, and I have this incapacity. And we have to simply let what happens happen based on these dynamics. And we want to believe that's true. So this dream figure is confronted with dream pirates, and you say, "Well, I just got to let this play out." You know, that's instead of saying, "Hey, wait a minute. Guess what? The dream pirates just vanished, and now you're in this beautiful beach with perfect safety." And we think, no, I can't deprive this dream figure of a learning lesson here. They have to learn how to cope with vulnerability on their own. You know? But these are just dream figures. They're not real. They're just projections of our imagination. They're like unborn children. They're not real children. They're like puppets. So we can't teach them anything, actually. It looks like we're teaching because we keep shifting the experiencing of these dream figures to make it seem like they're learning something. But they're not learning anything. We're just changing our imagining to make it seem like they're intelligent, they're learning something, and they're progressing or something. It's not true at all. These dream figures are just this is all just a figment of our imagination, of spirit's imagination. And we say to God, "Look, God, no, no, they're learning, they're progressing." And God says, "No, that's not true. You're just shifting the dream a little bit, very rapidly. And creatively, to make it seem like there's all this learning taking place, learning to be less vulnerable, learning to be more capable." God says, "No, you're just shifting the dream a little bit here, you know, there, like that." And any instant you could drop the entire dream altogether, stop dreaming this altogether. So you're not proving anything. So we can say, "I've never proved anything to God. I know I've never proved anything to God. I've already not proved anything to God. I already know that I've never proved anything to God." Say this now. Okay. "I already know that I have never proved anything whatsoever to God. I already know I've never provided the slightest bit of evidence to God of incapability." About that for helping us wake up. I already know that I have never provided the slightest trace of any of evidence of incapability to God. So there's no evidence to lose, is there? But I want to change the dreaming to a waking dream, so to speak. I'm not losing any evidence. Like, oh gosh, I lost some real valuable evidence. I had some real valuable evidence there. I was holding on to precious crumbs of evidence. At least that was something. No, I already know I never had any evidence whatsoever to present to God of incapability. Zero, not even the tiniest crumb of evidence to present to God, you see. I can present whatever evidence I want to the dream figures. You know, I just have them agree. Just have them do whatever I want them to do. But to God, I've never been able to present the slightest bit of evidence to God of incapacity. So, certainly don't have anything to lose. I don't have any evidence to lose. There's no evidentiary loss at all. There's no evidentiary loss is impossible. I already know that evidentiary loss is impossible. Because there is no evidence. How can I lose what doesn't exist? I already know I can't lose what doesn't exist. These are the silly little habits that we have that we need to bring to light and train our mind differently. Say, hey, I already know that evidentiary loss is impossible. I already know I can't suffer evidentiary loss because I don't have any. So I already know I'm completely free of suffering evidentiary loss. I can never suffer from evidentiary loss. I already know I can never suffer from evidentiary loss. And this should take a big weight off of us. I already know it's totally impossible for me to suffer any evidentiary loss. I've never had any evidence. So it is this fear of evidentiary loss that is really potently keeping us holding on, clinging. You see, we say, well, I'm not sure where the evidence is, but I know it must be somewhere. I don't want to lose it. I've got to have some. I think I must have somewhere the evidence. I'm just not sure where it is. Maybe I misfiled it or something. But no, we don't have any evidence at all. There is no evidence. We cannot present any evidence to God because there isn't any evidence to present. So we also cannot suffer any evidentiary loss at all. It's impossible. So this is dramatic progress right here. Talking about how I cannot suffer loss. The only loss that we could possibly suffer is evidentiary loss, actually, right? Yeah. The only loss that, being spirit, that we could possibly think we could suffer is evidentiary loss of incapability. And we now know there is no such evidence, so we can't suffer evidentiary loss. That's great. And just full stop in the wow of this. Don't overanalyze it. This is a very unexpected. I just sat down here. I didn't know what to expect. It's very unexpected. I've never thought of this before like this, no. It's quite staggering. So the reason why we hold on to all of this stuff is we don't want to lose any evidence. And since we don't know where the evidence is, we try to hold on to everything. Let's keep it all going. And I can't quite locate the evidence yet, you know. So I gotta keep sick, keep getting old, keep dying, keep suffering, keep all these problems. Because all these problems are potential evidence. I know it's evidence is somewhere, I just can't quite identify it yet. But I'll wait a little while, maybe I'll get it. Now you realize that there is no evidence. So what do we have to keep the same? Out of fear of evidentiary loss. We don't need to keep the same dream. Already admitted to God, God, I know I don't have any evidence to give you whatsoever. I already know I have no evidence whatsoever to present. Never will. So I already know that evidentiary loss is impossible. We can't lose what doesn't exist. Can't lose what doesn't exist. See, we're looking at this. And we're not intellectually analyzing. It's not an intellectual exercise of analysis and putting concepts together. We're actually aware and looking at this dynamic. We're actually seeing it and saying, wow, this is what I've been doing. Wow. This is why I'm afraid to let go of this dream. I feel somehow, I must lose some evidence. And now I'm realizing there isn't any, I won't lose a speck of evidence. I won't even lose a speck of evidence, none. There's no evidence whatsoever to support our position that there's some sort of incapacity taking place. We're only manipulating the dream to make it, and then claiming there's this narrative that this is, you know, happening to these figures. This is, that amounts to something that they're doing. They're not doing anything. There isn't any evidence of incapacity being generated at all by our subtle manipulation of this dream. Dream figures aren't learning anything. They're not losing anything. They're not gaining anything. Just because we dreamed that a dream figure now has something, some gold in its hands, that doesn't mean a dream figure gained the gold. We just dreamed that the gold is there now. And when we dream that the gold is not there, the dream figure didn't lose the gold. Nothing happened to the dream figure. No capacity or incapacity is present there. It's not the one who gained the gold. We just imagined it had the gold. So when it doesn't have the gold, it didn't lose the gold. We just decided that we're going to have a dream figure without gold. So that the dream figure didn't experience any incapacity or loss. Not at all. It's just, they're just symbols. So there isn't any evidence whatsoever to present to God of any incapacity. Never will be in dreams and dream symbols, using symbols and dreams. So there's no evidence generated at all. So just admit it to God. Say, God, I know I have absolutely no evidence to present to you of incapacity. I'm aware, I'm already aware that I have no evidence whatsoever. I never will have any. This is good to get that off your chest and just tell God that. And say, I know, you're right. You're absolutely right. This has all just been a silly game. So our fear, the fear of loss, is the fear of loss of evidence. But since we've already accepted and told God, you're right, there is no evidence. I've just been subtly manipulating the dream all along, trying to make it appear that there's evidence, but there isn't. So it's okay. I'm not afraid of loss because I can't lose what I don't have. See, can't lose what I don't have. So I can see dream figures that are all just happy as can be. And that remind me of my own happiness, right? I can see dream figures that have no notion of incapacity whatsoever. And that will remind me of the fact that there is no such thing as incapacity. I don't have any incapacity. I can see beauty that is not being incapacitated in any way. And I can say, see, there's no incapacity at all. And so not seeing incapacity in any way, dream way, doesn't mean I'm losing any evidence. See, doesn't mean I'm losing any evidence at all. There's no evidence there. Can't lose any evidence because there isn't any. So we're getting there. We're getting there like this. we'd see this. So just, oh, that's in the wow phase. Okay, so wow. This is just stunning. Stunning turnaround here. Unexpected. For me, unexpected, absolutely. I didn't know I could even do this or look at it this way. Saturday night, all sorts of denizens of the night are crawling around. They could be taping, you know, they could be listening, they could be watching, I mean, they could be considering this, you know. Instead, they're out, you know, gambling, cavorting, trying to have fun. Dream figures trying to work on their incapacity. Even when I was doing that, I didn't want to be doing it. I said, what am I doing? I'm wearing just a waste. This is ridiculous. But that's what everybody's doing. So I said, wow, if I don't do this, everybody think I'm weird. And if you try to wake up from this dream, everyone will think you're weird is the problem, right? So I had to kind of say, well, you know, kind of say, sort of, what can I do that doesn't seem so weird? Oh, I can read the Bhagavad Gita or something, the Bible or Bhagavad Gita or whatever. And people say, well, he's kind of weird, but not too weird. Okay. Go to school. What did you do last weekend? What did you do Saturday night? I was just at home reading these spiritual books. Wow, that's kind of weird. Whatever. You can't say, well, I was at home meditating and realizing that loss is impossible. Then they'd say, that's too weird. I think you need to come to the, you know, get out more. You need to get out more. But I'm someone who didn't get out more. I said, no, I think I need to stay in more. Now, what does a guru do? A guru just legitimizes people staying in more. They think, oh yeah, that's okay, that's great. Yeah, you meditate 10 hours a day, that's great. That's very helpful. But in our society, no, you're supposed to be out, and you're supposed to be realizing your potential. You're supposed to be working on limiting your incapabilities, getting rid of your incapability. All a dream. We don't have any evidence of incapability actually at all. It's weird. I mean, people, young people actually get out and just wander around the streets in the dark, driving, wandering, walking. Wow, you know, it's like Saturday night. I don't particularly like wandering around in the streets in the dark. Well, good thing, I look back in hindsight, good thing I spent all this time just sitting. Because then I could say to God, hey God, let's change the dream. Why not? Let's show a dream of no incapacity. At least they'll remind me of the truth. You know? Of course, there's no evidence being generated there either in a dream. There's never any evidence being generated. So there's never any evidence being generated. Why not see a dream of you know, freedom from any incapacity? Why not? It helps me wake up. I have to say, God, Holy Spirit, Jesus, spiritual teachers have been totally unobtrusive. You know, they never intruded upon me. Sometimes I wish they would have, you know. I just, hey, Jesus, where are you? You know, I don't know. It's completely unobtrusive. They're working, you know, they're doing, certainly doing so behind the scenes very unobtrusively. But you see, if you have the capacity to sit still, you know, you may be a bookworm, you may be somebody that's used to just sitting in one place for a long time quietly. That's very helpful, actually. It's very difficult for people of action. Very difficult, you know, to realize. Very difficult. And this is what the world is selling. Everyone, be a person of action. Don't be that little homebody who sits quietly, you know, knitting or being very quiet. Don't be that way. Be a person of action. Get out there. Compete. Compete, 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 compete. Actualize yourself. Be successful. Prove that you're not incapable. You know? So, when you think that this is what you're supposed to, your attention is supposed to be engaged with, action, 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 this is a problem. How do you convert this realization that there is no evidence into action? You cannot convert it like that. First, you have to just mellow out in the wow of it. Drop it and stay quiet. So certainly I am totally aware of the difficulty of, especially when you're young, to be a stay-at-homer. Just because you don't feel you're participating in the culture of your peers and growing with your peers and having shared experiences that you can relate to one later on in life and all this stuff, you know. Not part of the sorority, not part of the fraternity. Nobody really knows you. If you start, don't participate in anything, nobody knows you. Like, nobody knew who I was in high school, really. Yeah, it's weird. I walked around high school and I realized nobody had a clue who I was, basically. Almost nobody had any idea who I was. And even those who did, they forgot after a while. So I didn't really want to go to high school. Why would I want to go? Going to a place nobody even knows who I am. I didn't even get voted least likely to succeed because nobody even knew who I was. So I, you know, I didn't have any signatures in my yearbook at all. None. Because I really was not participating, you know, in the life of high school. I stopped participating in the life of school by about seventh grade. I said, no, this is, you know, I need to focus in, sit quietly here, and untangle this confusion that's going on here. So those who may feel marginalized and, you know, sitting quietly, being able to do, this is not marginalization. This is a awakening. You're going towards awakening from a nightmare. Really, feeling that somehow you were trapped with fear of loss. You're literally realizing there's no cause for the fear of loss at all. Therefore, you can be free of this dream. You're free of this dream. Once you settle this issue of loss once and for all, and you're free. You're going to be free of this dream. Permanently free. Never to be beguiled again, really. Unless you really want to be. So we're touching upon the real hot wire of the whole situation is this fear of loss of evidence. In order to try to justify to God, yeah, well, this is all necessary, God. And, you know, we have to imagine that there must be evidence to present. And, but when we're honest, we say, God, I don't have a speck of evidence to present to you because I realized this was all just a play of my creativity trying to, you know, con you into thinking that there was evidence when in fact I know, I admit, totally admit and see that this isn't zero evidence, not a speck of evidence, that there's the slightest bit of incapability at all taking place here. So, the fear of loss of evidence is totally unfounded, has no ground whatsoever, doesn't exist, no basis for it whatsoever. We just thought we could be so creative, our creativity was so great, we could actually manufacture evidence. But no, it's just great creativity is all it is. Great creativity is just great creativity. It never turns into evidence of something else, of incapacity. Never generates that. Always it is free. We're always free. So we just have to, you know, just keep admitting this to God and say, God, this is, I know, I see it. You're right. You're right. You're right. You're right. Absolutely right. There's no cause for fear whatsoever. Now, we realize, hey, this is of the utmost magnitude for us. Sure, but we're still full stop in the wow. That's why we're sitting here quietly. Is full stop in the wow of this. Wow. This has the ultimate magnitude to it. This is the hot button right here. We found the hot button. Great. Okay. Don't have to push the button or what happens if I push. Don't even think about that. Don't project forward. Just accept the fact I found the hot button. Okay, this is it. Don't project forward. Just see how it feels right now. Just get comfortable with it right now. Just as it is. Right here, right now. Yeah, the loss of evidence thing is that's the hot button, for sure. That's the glue that holds the whole dream together, keeps it going. That's it. So if we already are good with God, saying, God, this was just, which means I wasn't free. And I realized I just thought, I tried to use my creativity to convince you. I realized you can't be convinced of what doesn't exist. It's impossible. So there isn't any evidence. I can't lose any evidence because it doesn't exist. Just keep on being honest like that. Admit it, you know, admit it. Repenting is to admit to God, yeah, God, this is what I tried to do. And all my claims, like, I can't change the dream because I'll lose the evidence. That's all bogus. That's all completely bogus. There isn't any evidence. The more we admit this to ourselves, to one another, to God, you know, get it out in the open. And the easier it is for us to say, okay, let's dream a dream where there is no imaginary evidence of incapacity. Let's make it easy on ourselves here. As long as we're dreaming, we might as well dream that, right? Because that has a practical, pragmatic application to remind us that there isn't any evidence to lose. We're not incapacitated. Even our dreams are not incapacitated. But of course, if we're dreaming of all this incapacitation and progress, it's tough for us to recognize there isn't any there. We're buying into it. We're trying to manufacture it. So if we just give up trying to manufacture it, it's a lot easier to then set dreaming down. So I don't even need to dream anymore, God. I know there's no evidence there, and I don't even now. I don't even feel like I don't even need to dream at all anymore. It's a lot easier to set down dreaming altogether when there's a final dream of no dream incapacity at all. It's a lot easier because there's nothing to buy into. There's no worry about evidence, losing evidence of incapacity at all. There, we just say, well, obviously there isn't any there, it's obvious. Easy to, no fear at all at that point, you see. Right now we may say, I know there's no evidence, but I'm still a little nervous. So first, so that we don't stop dreaming right away, we have a dream, a happy dream, so to speak, a dream that appears no incapacity, and then from that standpoint, easy to just say, oh, obviously, no matter how I use my creativity in dreams, it never results in incapacity. So there's no point in, it's kind of foolish to use my creativity that way. Using my creativity to try to fool God, that's not that fun, actually. Seemed like fun when we started out, but I'd much rather create with God, you know, and use the creativity together, and you know, there's better ways to use it, for sure. Cooling down from this a little bit. Make sure we put in our block of time. Well, not really, we haven't put in that much time, have we? Not that much. Well, that's pretty significant, but that's fine. There's more transients walking about. Just let this settle in, that's all. It's like you eat a great meal, just let it settle in. You know if it's, you know, full of great nutrients, you know it's going to be good for you. So we just ate this excellent meal. Now we just let it settle in. Tonight should be interesting. Sleeping, dreaming, sleeping. Wow, I don't know what's going to happen from here on out, but that's why we don't try to project too far ahead. Just stay in the now. Just let this settle in. I'm sure nothing will happen until I'm ready for it to happen. So don't try to think ahead. Just stay in the now. See, there is no possibility of loss of evidence. Wow. That really changes the equation completely. So we'll see, we will see. But I feel calm. And just let it settle in. This is big time. We found the hot button, absolutely. Finally found it, great. All right, we'll see how it goes next. Very great, that's it.